perform some bridgings on the data of the Cagone River Basin for the presentation. We will try to be fast because after what I will do is to describe the SIM files to make you understand, and then if you have any question, we are here, you can do. And then Nicolò will show you the result of the cridgings and the comparison between for the LIB1 out, because what you did before was to run the LIB1 out cross-validation, and you finished, I think the process is finished, but you didn't visualize yet the result. We will do it later with Nicolò through a notebook Python already implemented for you. So now we will pay attention on the cridging. And so you can ask, but why it's different respect to the LIB1 out? It's different because with the LIB1 out, you don't perform estimation. You perform your estimation just in the station that you removed. Okay. Instead, now with the cridging, we perform an estimation in a point where we don't have measurements, which is the centroid of the ESRO, for example. Okay. So whereas before we remove a station and we perform the interpolation where the station was, what we will do now, we extend our measure, we interpolate in points where we don't have data. For example, the shapefile of the ESROP centroids. Is this okay? Clear? Okay. So, if this is clear, we can move to the description of the simulation number 5, cridging point precipitation. Cridging because it is a cridging point, because it's a point interpolation. This is this specifies that we provide the interpolation just in a set of points, but we have another capability, is to provide a raster map, not a point map. And eventually we will look at it at the end of this lecture. So it means that in this case we provide as output a time series, one time series of rainfall for each point in which we want the interpolation. In the other case, in the raster mode, we will provide a raster map for each time step, not just a time series. Okay? Do you want I repeat, or it is clear? It's clear? Do you have any question? No. Okay. So let's look first at the point precipitation. Precipitation, why? Because we are interpolating the precipitation. You are now you are more or less very familiar with this. Let's look at the components. And the components is a raster reader, which it is going to read a time series of what? Of precipitation. And for each time, so for each row of our file, we read the input data, which means the data that are measured at the stations in which we have measurements. And we read it with the reader data. Then another ingredient is the cridging parameters. And the cridging parameters, it is also a time series because it could vary hour by hour, month by month, season by season. And we have already seen how to construct this time series of parameters. And you have seen with Nicolò in the last presentation. And then we need to read the shapefile of the station, but then we need also one more shapefile, which is the shapefile of the points where we want the interpolation. So in this case, the interpolate station is the shapefile of the Hilsrock centroids, of the sub-basin centroids. Is it clear? Why? Because we want to interpolate the precipitation for each Hilsrock centroid. Then we call the cridging components, and finally we write the interpolation CSV file. How do you image this CSV file? This CSV file has a number of row equals to the number of time step for which we perform our simulation, and a number of columns equal to the number of centroids where we perform our simulation. Is it clear? Do you have a question?
We need centroids shapefile.
Perfect.
Plus a slope shapefile.
No, plus just the station shapefile, the measured station, which are the rain gauge station for the presentation. Any other question? No? Okay, let's see how we specify the parameters. Okay, the reader data is the same of the precipitation data that we already seen for the semi-variogram estimate. So we have the path to the precipitation, the ID, which is the name of the ID of the precipitation data, start date and end date, time step of the simulation, we already seen it is hourly. So in minutes is 60, and then the no value flag. Then we need to read the time series of the optimal parameters for the kriging. And as you can see, this depends on the best semivariogram that we have already found. No? And now I go to open this file, and I'll show you how it looks like. So the name is kriging. For example, we open the Bessel one, and you see is a time series file that has you just created before with the notebook of Python, and has for each time step, which is for each hour of our simulation period, it has three value, and these three value are exactly the nuggets, the seal, and the range that we estimated by the particle swarm, and so those are the optimal parameter set. When I opened the kriging param total, Bessel total, I remember that for you we were meaning just the mean of the entire over the entire simulation period, but we have also the seasonal, for example, which means that those values will change season by season. Okay. Theoretically, those values can change even hour by hour, and this means execute a particle swarm for each hour of your simulation time. Is this clear? Do you have any question? No. Okay. So we will read this time series, and in fact we provide this information to the kriging to the kriging component, and then we need to read the shapefile of the meteorological station, which is station Basilicata, and finally we specify the path to the Heathrop centroids, which is the set of points where we want the interpolation. Each of these centroids has an ID. If you open your set file, you will see that you have a field which is named ID. So this is the ID of our centroids. And then the output shapefile will contain this ID. So we will have one column for each centroid, and each centroid is identified by this ID. Then we need the semivariogram type. So for example, I opened the Bessel one before, so kriging need to know that nugget, seal, and range belong to that particular type of semivariogram. And for this example, the semivariogram type is on here, and it is the linear one. But if you also have estimated the optimal parameter set for the circular one, then you can provide that semivariable type and the corresponding optimal parameter set. And finally, the important things are the writer of the output, where you specify the path where you want to write the interpolation, the interpolated value, and the time step and start date. If we look at the connection, it's quite self-explicative as well, because we read the precipitation data from reader data, and we provide those data at the creaking component. Then we read the parameters value from reader param, and we provide it to the creaking. And then we read the station and the interpolation point. And finally, we pass the output of the creaking component to the writer that will write those data. Any question? Clear? Okay, we can also run. And in means, so you will see many iterations because it will be performed step for each, it will be performed for each hour of our simulation time period. So if you don't have question here, I will move to the just to the description of the second example. Do you have question? Please don't be shy and it's not.
So we will give a uniform precipitation for each subject. What do you precipitation to the centroid? Okay.
So the precipitation is uniform for each subject.
Okay.
Yes. Other question? Okay, I will show you also how to run the trended creaking, which is I think for most of you it's quite well known. Otherwise, we will see it a little bit. So the difference. So the trending creaking that I implemented here originally in New Age was taken by Garen and Marx that provides an algorithm for quite helpful for a meteorological variable in a mountain environment. Why? Because usually precipitation has a strong trend with elevation. And so what Garen and Marx did was to don't creak directly the precipitation value, but the trend, check if there is a trend. If the trend is existing, then and is significant, then you detrend the data. So you compute the differences between the mean component, which is the slope of the trend, and the precipitation value, and then you perform the creaking to the residuals, not directly to the precipitation itself. After you get the creaking of the residual, it will be added to the mean trend component. Okay, and this is very well, and this suits very well meteorological variables that show some trend with elevation or also with other kind of interpolation for any kind of data with trend. Everything is exactly the same respect to the other, to the creaking component, except one thing. We were speaking about trend and we were speaking about elevation. So what do you think we will to tell the creaking if we want to perform at the trended one? What is missing as information that we should provide?
Mm,
The elevation from the station, and not only, and the centroid's elevation. Otherwise, you cannot add the determinant. You cannot compute with the station, and you cannot add the determinant. And in fact, we will see that if you open your centroid file, you will see that there is a field which is F point Z, named the pit filler, that and that pit filler contains the elevation of the centroids. In case you want to know how we build this future, more or less the procedure is the same of the procedure that we apply for computing the area of each centroid. So there is a formula in, there is a specific plugin in QGIS, but there will be a specific plugin in each GIS you are used to use. Okay? So it's something just quite simple, and eventually, if you are interested, we can show you on Friday that we will do that. Okay? But the important thing is that here, differently from the ordinary kriging that we were running, here we need also the information about elevation. Do you have any question? No? Okay. I'll show you also the last one, which is, I want to make you notice one more thing, which is this row here.
Giuseppe, please, can you repeat the how the deep-ended kriging works, please?
Yes.
Just few.
Okay, so you have the precipitation that shows, you have the precipitation data, and you have the column of your elevation of the station. You can plot the precipitation value for that direct time step against the elevation data, and you can check if, and you do a linear regression in practice. So you can see the significance of this linear regression, and in practice you check the slope, if the slope is and you check the slope and the p-value of the slope, for example. And when you see that the trend, there is a trend, and the trend is significant, then you can detrain your data, and it just means that you compute the residual between your linear regression, if you hear your x and y, and you see there is a trend, and the trend is significant, so you don't perform your regression. You don't perform the regression directly, you don't perform the kriging directly on the precipitation value, but you perform the kriging of the residual between your mean component, which is the regression line, and your precipitation value. But it's not enough, because what the kriging provides is the kriging of the residual. So you then have to go back and add the mean component, which is the slope of your trend. And this is done automatically. You just have to tell him, so what he needs for doing all this stuff is the column of the that specifies the elevation of each station. And of course, he also needs the elevation of the centroids to add the trend at the centroid elevation, okay? Yes?
But to do all this, you have to fit against the variogram.
To do all this, you have to fill the variogram of the residual.
Mm-hmm. But it does it with this code, or we should have started from the beginning?
It is probably better that you start with the variogram of the residual.
Okay.
Okay. So not with the variogram. In fact, I wanted just to show the possibility of running this kind of kriging, but the exercise that we will do is on the ordinary kriging. Why? Because we want to, we already fitted the variogram to the just precipitation value, okay? More or less here. Any other questions? No questions? Okay, last things I want to show of this example is this row here. Because we were also speaking about our type of kriging, that is the local kriging. What the local kriging does is things like that. So you have your river basin and you want to interpolate somewhere in the centroids of each hilltop, and you have the station, and the station are here. So to be consistent, those are the hilltop centroids, as in the example before, and then you have station, no? And your station can be here, 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 but also your station here, and here, and here, and here. So you can do a kriging that just consider local data, and so assuming that this station here doesn't influence too much in this point. Or a local one could be also something like this, okay? And so you need, what you need to know is the number of closer stations that you want to consider in your kriging interpolation. So if you have 60 stations and you want to interpolate in a centroid that is, for example, here, then what the algorithm does is, and you put here, for example, the number four, what the algorithm does is to compute the distance between the centroids and the stations, sort these distances by distance, and take only the four stations that are closer to it, and perform the kriging with them. In this way, for example, these centroids will be influenced by this station here, and these centroids will be influenced by this station here. Yes?
But it always takes the xy distance, so it doesn't consider the relation.
No, it doesn't, but it is a planar distance.
Yeah, planar. Mm-hmm.
Any question? No? Okay. Very, very last, but we don't run it because it takes a lot, is the raster kriging. The raster kriging, it's the same things that we have already seen, but it doesn't perform a kriging just few points, like in the shape file, but it performs the kriging for a raster map. Okay, so you need your station, which are still the points, the dots here, and then it needs a raster map as input, and is able to compute the kriging for each point of this raster map, for each pixel of the raster map. Okay, so the result won't be a time series, so one value in the centroids for each time step, but will be a set of raster maps, one for each hour of your simulation period. So as you can see, what is changing here, what is that we are changing now respect to the previous one?
Giving
the raster map. So instead of having as input the interpolate the centroid shape file. You don't want anymore to interpolate on the centroids, but you need a raster map, no matter which raster map, no matter the value that it contains, because you just need a raster map to extract the geometry, number of cell, resolution, and resolution and like low left corner to interpolate in that geometry. Okay, so in the last case, you don't have a shapefile input of the centroids, but you have a raster map. Here we call probably DM, reader DM file. We provide a DM, but if you provide the aspect or slope or curvature, it doesn't mean it doesn't matter because it just extracts the geometry. It wants to know where to interpolate. And so the result will be a raster map for each tensor. And of course, also in the raster case, you can enjoy the local kriging or the trended kriging. Any question? Okay, now